She was a single mother who finally got lucky in love.
He was this really handsome and charming doctor.
The chemistry was instant.
Eyes met, hearts met.
Things started to get serious.
But then everything went horribly wrong.
Where's your emergency?
I'm afraid we have a dead body.
It was on every news channel. Woman found partially nude.
Her body was left in a desolate area near the water.
She was stabbed over 22 times.
How could somebody do such a thing?
Was she a random victim?
What was this guy doing in a desolate area?
He apparently didn't call 911 or stick around.
Had the killer come from her past?
He never got over the breakup.
He still loved her very much.
Or did someone else have reason to want her dead?
She's no longer going to be a secret.
It puts the murder in a whole new light.
Only a monster would do that.
October 29th, 2013. It's Tuesday afternoon in Williamsburg, New York, a budding Brooklyn neighborhood just across the East River from Manhattan.
The hipsters are there, people are brunching, folks are outside all the time.
It's become a very fashionable place to live.
Old warehouses were torn down, high-rises were built, rent skyrocketed, and it's still evolving.
But even the trendiest neighborhoods aren't immune to violence.
Around 3:30 p.m., NYPD dispatch receives a 911 call.
Where's your emergency?
I'm afraid we have a dead body over here.
The caller reports a body covered by a blanket along the riverwalk.
It's a male or a female?
I don't know. I can only see a hand sticking out.
The operator dispatched first responders and then handed over the caller to EMS.
Sir?
Yeah.
Would you like to help by doing a chest compression?
No. I'm not gonna move. This body's no way.
When first responders arrived minutes later, they confirmed the caller's assessment.
Police determined right away that the victim is deceased.
The victim is a young woman, dead from multiple stab wounds.
That appeared to be a homicide.
She was left there on the ground in the concrete by some trash with a blanket on top of her.
There is no ID on the body, but there may be another way to identify her.
Upon further examination, they noticed that she had a tattoo on her shoulder.
They plugged that information into the missing person database and they actually get a hit.
Police were able to determine that the deceased woman was named Mercedes Young.
A 35-year-old mother of two, family had always been at the center of Mercedes' life.
Mercedes Young was a hardworking single mom who always put her children first.
She was a mother of two kids, a 15-year-old son and an 8-year-old daughter.
Mercedes was a very loving sister, a loving mother, my best friend.
Growing up, she'd always stood out from the crowd.
She was a very energetic, accomplished person.
She loved attention. She always had, like, the ability to snag the most popular boy.
She was very popular. She was really into fashion. She dreamed of being a dancer.
Mercedes loved to dance. Like, I remember when we were younger, we used to call ourselves the Fly Girls. And we used to kind of like try to learn the dances from the girls from A Living Color. She would wake up in the morning, like put on her red Reebok classic. She would do her hair and she would lay her edges down. I idolized her.
But Mercedes' love of life was often at odds with her strict religious upbringing.
We were Jehovah's Witnesses growing up, and so in that religion, you can't really associate with people that are not Jehovah's Witnesses because they're considered worldly. And so Mercedes was running the streets, getting into trouble, not going to school, and so my mom couldn't handle it as a single parent.
Unable to control her rebellious teenager, Mercita's mother placed her in a group home.
My mom placed her because she needed help with my sister's behaviors, and she lived on a residential campus and would come home on the weekends on home visits. I really didn't understand what was going on. I just knew that my mom sent her away, and when she was coming home on the weekend, I would get super excited because I knew that the weekend would be coming and she would be coming home, and we would be able to spend time together and just really bond.
It was a difficult situation, but Mercita made the best of it.
She started to do a lot better, and I was just really proud of her for like turning her life around.
After high school, Mercita was determined to make something of herself.
She became a home health aide, and she took care of elderly people for quite some time. And then after that, she wanted to pursue being a dietitian.
And by her late 20s, Mercita had an established career and two young children.
Mercita was a great mom. Her children were her main focus.
She was a young mom, but she didn't let that stop her. She still made sure her kids were taken care of and had everything they needed.
But as a single mom, things weren't always easy.
My niece was born bow-legged. It affected her walking. She would constantly trip over her own feet. And so my sister started to seek services for her.
They spent a lot of time going to different doctor's offices.
Luckily, Mercita wasn't always alone, though. She'd found a man she could lean on named Gerald Douglas.
Hey, everyone.
They had a great bond.
Mercita was hoping that it would escalate to something real, something serious.
However, the relationship had its challenges.
Gerald had a record.
And when that landed him in jail for a while, Mercita broke things off with Gerald.
You're always supposed to be treated like a queen, and if it's not like that, they gotta go. That was her motto.
Mercita didn't stay single for long, though. In the fall of 2009, she had a new, more promising man in her life.
In the course of taking her daughter in for doctor appointments, she met Mr. Alex Jeffrey.
I'm gonna need to see the princess in about 3 weeks.
Okay, that's fine.
Ms. Young was very impressed by this young doctor.
He was really good with her daughter. And, you know, they started talking and everything, and the chemistry was really good.
And I think I need to see you this weekend.
Really?
There was a physical and chemical connection in that moment.
That's where things started between them.
They spent an entire weekend talking and texting, and they went on their first date.
For Mercita, it was a dream come true.
He was this tall, good-looking, very articulate young man who just swept her off her feet.
It was very comforting for her to meet someone who understood her daughter's disability as well.
Ms. Young was very much in love.
In fact, Mercita was hoping for a marriage proposal.
But now, in the early morning hours of October 29th, the couple's future is cut short when police discover Mercita's body near the East River.
She suffered multiple stab wounds to her face, neck, and chest.
She had cuts and slashes on her hands.
And more evidence at the crime scene might give detectives the motive behind the killing.
Mercita's sweatshirt was pulled up to expose a breast, and her pants were pulled down around her knees.
It appeared that this had been a sex crime and not just a murder.
Single mother of two, Mercita Young, had finally found love with a handsome young doctor named Alex Jeffrey.
They went on their first date and hit it off, and 3 years later, they're still going strong.
He was a great guy, he was very attentive, and they had a loving relationship.
Alex checked all the boxes.
But now, Mercita has been found stabbed to death on the Brooklyn waterfront.
She suffered multiple wounds to the face, the neck, and the chest, and her throat was slashed.
It appears Mercita may have also been sexually assaulted.
Her body was found partially nude. And they noticed that she had a lot of stab wounds in her hands, which was apparent that she was trying to defend herself against the attacker.
The presumption was, in many instances, when you find a young woman like that, that there was a rape.
Detectives order a rape kit to be performed during her autopsy.
Other than that, there was little else detectives could initially glean from Mercedes' body.
At first glance, it seems there's not much to learn from the crime scene either.
This particular crime scene, it was full of debris.
It was difficult to determine what could have been connected to the murder and what could have just been dumped there.
But as detectives sift through the waste, crime scene investigators find what could be an important clue.
They found more blood on the metal railings, and the railings are running along the edge of the river.
But it's what's in the blood that gets their attention.
The police were able to pick up a few fingerprints from those railings.
When you have a fingerprint in blood, it's pretty strong evidence because it's hard for someone to explain what their print is doing in blood at the scene.
They are what's known in forensics as a patent fingerprint.
Unlike latent fingerprints that detectives have to dust to make visible, a patent fingerprint is a visible image of a person's fingertip left on the surface as the result of residue on the finger, such as blood, oil, ink, or dirt.
They are able to send it to be compared in the police database.
Then, as the CSI team finishes processing the scene, detectives spread out to canvass the area.
It quickly becomes clear that it's a long shot that anyone's seen anything.
Mercedes' body was found in an area where it's still known for an industrial zone. It was a dead-end street.
Detectives tried to find something, a witness, just a clue of anything. And they searched the area, but it was such a desolate and remote area, there was hardly any evidence to be found.
It's an area that doesn't see much foot traffic outside of the employees that actually work there.
It's unlikely they're going to find any witnesses to this crime.
Although when detectives inquire at the warehouse next door to the crime scene, they may be in luck.
The manager puts police in touch with the employee that made the call to 911.
He confirmed that, yes, he made the call.
He says that he placed the call around the time he started his shift.
You just happened to see her down by the water?
No, not exactly.
In a surprising turn, he stated that he wasn't the one that actually spotted Mercita.
I was walking to work and this guy, he just came up to me.
Hey, you got a phone?
Yeah, what?
The man told him they had found a body at the end of the street.
You should probably call 911.
He said I should call 911 and then he left.
He didn't stick around?
No, he just rode off.
The bike rider's actions seemed highly suspicious to the detectives.
Number one, what was this guy doing at that time of day on a bicycle in a desolate area? And number two, why did he then take off?
Could he be Mercedes' killer?
The man who called 911 after discovering Mercita Young's dead body has given detectives what may be a promising lead in their search for her killer.
The 911 caller reported that the man who actually saw the body was a man on a bike. He rode up and said he found a dead body.
Police are suspicious of this bicyclist because he apparently didn't call 911 or stick around for the police to come.
Now the detectives are wondering if this could be her killer.
This guy on the bike. Have you seen him around before?
No.
Can you tell us what he looked like?
The 911 caller is able to give police a basic description of the man.
All he can say is he's a white male who appears to be in his 40s.
Which in one of New York City's trendiest neighborhoods wasn't all that helpful for detectives.
Still, detectives are determined to track down the man who supposedly found the body.
The police asked some of the other businesses in the neighborhood if any of their security cameras show this particular white man on a bicycle.
The search leads nowhere.
The detectives found a couple of tapes that confirm there was a cyclist that left the area, but nothing that's detailed enough to allow for proper identification.
The bloody fingerprint found at the crime scene also appears to be a dead end.
There were no matching prints in the police database.
With that, the investigators are back at square one.
Police took over the intersection of Division and Kent Streets in Williamsburg this evening. They are looking for evidence, witnesses, anything to help them figure out what happened to the woman who was found dead here this afternoon.
However, before releasing Mercita's name to the press, detectives still need to notify her family that she has been found.
The family is devastated. They're confused.
They said, Mercita's dead. And I said, what do you mean she's dead?
I don't know how this could have happened.
I just was like, this is not happening to me. It's not happening to my family. I couldn't believe it.
And when detectives ask if there's anyone that might have a reason to hurt Mercita, her family says no.
They tell police she was a good mom and wasn't involved in anything that could have got her any type of trouble.
I don't know anyone that would have had this kind of problem with her.
However, Mercita's family is able to give detectives some information on her love life.
They tell the police that she's been dating a man named Alex Jeffrey, and as far as they've known, it's been going well.
We never met him.
They were aware of the fact that she was dating Alex, but they had never been formally introduced.
The family also mentions another man in Mercita's life, her ex, Gerald Douglas.
They had dated for many years ago.
When he was released from jail, the two reconnected and had remained friends.
He had still kept up a relationship in some way with Ms. Young.
He never really got over the breakup. I think he was hoping that they'd get back together.
So cops looked at Gerald and thought, well, you know, this is the ex-boyfriend. He's got a motive.
While Mercita had moved on, he still loved her very much. That could cause him to lash out.
Detective suspicions deepen when they pull Gerald's rap sheet.
Gerald has several previous arrests.
Based on his criminal record, they are inclined to think that perhaps he's capable of doing what happened.
Detective, there's someone here to see you.
The next morning, detectives ask Mercita's ex to come down to the station for questioning.
When he gets there, detectives are surprised that he's not alone.
Both of Mercita's children are with him.
However, when detectives sit down with Gerald, he offers an explanation.
He tells the police that Mercita didn't come home the night before and that her son reached out to him.
The kids got themselves up and went to school. They didn't know who else to call when they got home and she wasn't there.
It was Gerald who had helped them file the missing persons report earlier that day that aided the police in identifying the body.
But was he acting out of concern, or was he crafting a cover story?
Detectives ask him where he was the night of the murder, and he says he stayed in playing video games.
I swear, I never left the house.
It's basically an alibi that the police have no way to confirm.
There's nobody that can say that they saw him there or that they were with him.
But he swears that doesn't make him a killer.
When the police ask Gerald about the breakup between he and Ms. Young, he responds pretty casually and says that they had broken up almost a decade ago.
He says it's ancient history.
But you're still friendly.
Yeah. I help out with the kids sometimes.
Gerald explains to police that he's actually still on good terms with her and with the children.
Detectives also push Gerald about his feelings toward Mercita's new boyfriend, Alex.
They wanted to know, was there any kind of tension? Did he have any arguments, conflict?
He never had a problem with me. Mercedes made it clear. I'd be coming around with the kids. I never met him.
From the outset, you have to set boundaries. You have to say, you know, the kids are accustomed to this pattern and this person does this for them, so that's their role, and I really want to keep it that way.
And did you have any problems with Alex?
Well, I didn't like her going out with a guy.
Gerald admits that he had a problem with it. However, he says it's not because he was jealous.
She had confided in Gerald about the relationship that she had with this man.
I told her it wasn't right.
Why is that?
Was he abusive? Nah, know like that.
There was only one thing that concerns him.
Alex Jeffrey was married.
Mercedes Young's ex, Gerald Douglas, has just told detectives investigating her murder that the 35-year-old single mother was dating a married man.
He says that when Mercedes started dating Alex Jeffrey 3 years ago, he was already engaged to another woman.
As soon as I learned that he was engaged, I knew it was a bad idea.
Gerald was saying from the get-go, don't go out with this man. Do not deal with him. But love is blind.
She thought maybe she could convince him to change his mind.
I think a lot of times women think that if he can just see that I'm the real one for him, I'm the one who can make him happy, then he'll leave her. And they hold on to that hope because when they're together, it feels so real. The connection is real, the intimacy is real. So there's no way that he won't see it eventually. So they go forward with it, not thinking they're doing anything wrong because they are the real loves of his life.
But according to Gerald, Mercedes was wrong.
Alex ended up going through with the marriage to the other woman. Mercedes was devastated, but she just kept seeing him in secret.
She continued to hold out hope that eventually they would be together.
She was a young mother who was working, who had two children to care for, and who was trying to make ends meet. She wanted a man in her life who was there for her, not a man who was gonna say, I gotta get home to my wife, see you next week.
If what Gerald's telling detectives is true, it raises the possibility that Alex had something to do with her death.
Maybe she started telling him that unless he was willing to commit, unless he was willing to leave his wife, that she was going to make some trouble for him.
Or does Gerald have another reason to cast Alex as the bad guy?
Is Mercedes' ex looking to try to misplace blame?
Manipulators can be manipulators, and you can never know if that's just his motive, just to skirt the police away from him.
So, tell us what else you know about Alex.
Honestly, not much.
Gerald explains to police he's actually never met Dr. Jeffrey, and that Ms. Young's teenage son may actually know a little bit about him.
Gerald encouraged the police to talk to the oldest child.
Let's do that.
But when detectives sit down with Mercedes' 15-year-old, it looks like another dead end.
He tells police that he's never met Alex either.
He says he knows that his mom has been dating this man for years, but they always go out together.
Alex came by to pick her up, take her out, but never came in the house.
I never sat in the same room with him.
Hey, Mom.
Hey, baby.
Hey. Where are you going?
I'm just going out. Got a date.
Mercedes' son says that the last time he saw his mother was on Monday, October 28th.
He says it was around 3 or 4 when he got home from school.
Okay. Babe, I gotta go. Get your homework done. I love you. Give him a hug.
She was getting ready to go out to a concert with Alex. They were headed to the Barclays Center in Brooklyn.
So she told her son that, you know, her boyfriend was gonna come over and take her to a nice concert and basically go ahead and go to bed and don't wait up for me.
However, Mercedes' son also says that his mother or someone sent him a text a few hours later.
The son explains to the police that he did get a strange text message from his mom around 8:24 in the evening.
The text said, don't believe anyone. Did you finish your homework? Taking the train home.
At the time, he didn't think much of it.
He wasn't expecting her home early, so he got his sister put to bed, and then he went to sleep.
It wasn't until hours later that he realized something was wrong.
The next morning, he woke up. As usual to go to school, mom wasn't home, so he helped his sister like his mom would have to get her ready for school.
It's heartbreaking because here you have a 15-year-old boy who's been assigned the role of an adult.
By that afternoon, he hadn't heard anything from his mom, so he sent her a text. He asked her if she was okay, but he never received a response.
He was scared. He was worried about his mom. What could have happened?
That's when he reached out to Gerald, and they decided to fill out a missing persons report.
Now, detectives are investigating her murder, and Mercita's son offers what could be an important clue.
Even though Ms. Young's son has never actually met Dr. Jeffrey, he has seen his car.
According to Mercita's son, Dr. Jeffrey drives a Jeep.
After talking to Mercita's 15-year-old, questioning her boyfriend becomes the detective's top priority.
Not only was he cheating on his wife, but he's also the last person who saw Mercita alive.
Detectives pay a visit to Alex's home.
But instead of Alex, it's his wife who answers the door.
Can I help you?
Is your husband home, ma'am?
Not at the moment. Is something wrong?
Do you know a woman named Mercita Young?
No.
She says she has no idea who Mercita Young is.
Which means detectives had to explain the whole sordid situation to her.
Imagine how horrifying that must be. All of a sudden, police bang on your door, and they're asking about your husband, and they mention that he has a girlfriend.
So this was a total shock and surprise to her.
Or could it all be an act?
You have to scratch your head and wonder if she was covering for him. She's his wife. She must have had some suspicion. She must have had an inkling as to what was going on.
If she did, that gave her a motive for murder.
Police couldn't rule her out as a suspect.
And since they couldn't find Alex, they couldn't rule out the possibility that she'd killed him too.
When your husband gets home, can you have him give us a call, please?
Yes, I absolutely will.
After talking to his wife, detectives arrange for a detail to watch the house in case Alex returns.
Where he was at that time, we don't know.
Then detectives head to the Bronx to visit the clinic where Alex works.
Hello. We'd like to speak with Alex.
He's not here today.
He wasn't there either, but detectives took the opportunity to find out a little more about Mercita's boyfriend.
They're talking to his boss, they're talking to coworkers.
Alex was a great worker. He was responsible, he was, you know, good with his patients. He was reliable. He had a really good reputation at work. There was nothing bad to say about Alex.
And they were sure he had nothing to hide.
So the detectives ask if they can go into Dr. Jeffrey's office and look around, and the supervisors there let them in.
This is a regular office, nothing out of the ordinary.
But when the detectives open a desk drawer, they notice a black plastic bag inside that looks out of place.
When they open it, they found Mercita's cell phone, wallet, and ID.
Bingo. Busted.
Detectives investigating the murder of Mercita Young have just made an incriminating discovery in her boyfriend Alex Jeffrey's office.
They went through his desk, and lo and behold, what did they find? A bag containing Mercita's telephone, Mercita's wallet, and Mercita's ID.
The police take this evidence they found in the plastic bag and give it to their forensic team to see what they can learn.
However, it will likely take some time to get Mercita's phone unlocked.
In the interim, detectives subpoena Alex's phone records and continue staking out his house and workplace.
While the NYPD combs the streets for the suspected killer, the results come back from Alex's phone records.
Based on the phone records, they were able to see that Alex was the very last person that texted Mercita.
Without the phone itself, detectives were unable to view the content of the message. But it proved Alex and Mercita had been in contact that night.
Investigators also used the ping data from Alex's phone to chart his path on the night Mercita disappeared.
It shows where they were that evening, and it shows that Dr. Jeffrey picked up Ms. Young at her place, but they didn't go to a concert.
Alex drove down to the waterfront in Williamsburg.
And of course, this is the same spot where Ms. Young's body was found.
That evidence is damning. It places Alex at the scene of the crime at the same time that Mercita was killed.
If Alex was the killer, that explains why they didn't get a match on his fingerprints.
Alex's record was completely spotless.
His prints weren't in the system.
But they soon will be, once he's arrested for murder.
Within a few hours, detectives received a phone call from the officer watching Alex's apartment. A Jeep that's a match for Alex's had pulled up outside.
Let me see your hands. Put your hands up.
When the driver steps out, there's no doubt. That's Alex Jeffrey.
Police take Alex into custody without incident.
Inside Alex's vehicle, they find another piece of stunning evidence.
They found a plastic bag filled with blood-soaked paper towels.
Confident that they've arrested Mercedes' killer, detectives take Alex down to the station for questioning.
They read him his Miranda rights, and he agrees to answer their questions.
Now, I know how he looks, but it's not what you think.
He explains he met her a couple of years ago, and they've been meeting up a few times a month to have sex.
It was just a hookup, you know?
He says he was only interested in sex.
He had no plans on leaving his wife or breaking up his marriage.
This was only a quid pro quo. He wasn't going to get involved with her children. He wasn't going to engage in family events.
Alex said, look, I told her that from the get-go. I told her I didn't want anything serious.
He says Mercedo was okay with that, at first.
He thought they were okay with what their arrangement was. On again, off again, meetups and all of the other things that came with that.
It was sort of like a secretive thing. Not a lot of her friends knew about the relationship.
But as time went on, things began to change.
This happens. A lot of relationships that start out as friends with benefits or casual sexual relationships down the road morph into something else.
She started getting needy.
She would text him things like, don't you want to spend your whole life with me? Don't you want to be with me?
For Alex, the answer was no.
The relationship just was getting too intense for him. She wanted something more, and he wasn't ready for that.
He made it very clear he was not leaving his wife.
According to Alex, Mercedes didn't want to hear it.
She would fly into a rage and get very angry at him, and then they wouldn't talk for a while until Ms. Young would then start texting him again.
She'd always come back.
But Alex says that he knew Mercedes was never satisfied with their arrangement.
He said that she would do things like leave scratch marks on his back so that his wife could find out.
When he needed to get home, she would make him late.
So he wasn't really trusting her anymore.
He feels she was trying to sabotage his marriage.
According to Alex, Mercedes eventually came right out and admitted it.
The last straw for Alex was when she started to make a lot of threats.
She was going to tell his wife about the affair.
So you killed her?
No, it's not like that.
He swears he was just going to break things off with her once and for all.
Alex says that's why he arranged to take Mercedes out on Monday the 28th.
He admitted that he lied to her about taking her to a concert.
Why are we stopping?
Instead, he picked her up and he took her somewhere else where he could confront her in private.
Mercedes, we need to talk.
Dr. Jeffrey explains that he laid it all out there. He told her that, look, I'm just never, ever going to leave my wife for you. I'm not going to break up my marriage.
How'd she react to that? Well, it was weird.
No, you think you can just leave me?
I said, look, you gotta cut this fantasy thing out, okay? It's time.
You can't stop.
Even though Mercedes was upset, somehow the argument evolved to the two of them having sex in the car.
But according to Alex, it was all a distraction.
While that was happening, at some point she reached into her bag.
When he looked up, he saw she was holding a knife.
She tried to stab him in the chest.
You are not.
I grabbed her arm. And then?
Alex admits that he did kill Mercedes.
But he claims it wasn't murder. It was self-defense.
I just wanted her to stop.
Alex Jeffrey has just confessed to killing his girlfriend, Mercita Young. But he also claims he had no choice.
I know how it looks, but it's not what you think.
According to Alex, Mercita had pulled out a knife on him.
Alex says he caught her hand just in time to stop her from stabbing him.
Dr. Jeffrey explains that after blocking this initial stab attempt at his chest, that Ms. Young just continued to try to kill him.
She just went crazy.
They were tussling back and forth with this knife.
There was just no stopping her until finally he was really able to redirect the knife into her.
I never meant to hurt her.
Alex also says that when Mercita started bleeding out in his car, he panicked.
Instead of calling the police, he tried to cover up what he'd done.
He threw the knife into the water. Then he wrapped Mercita's body inside of a moving blanket that was already inside of his car.
Then he left her on the riverwalk and returned home to his wife in the Bronx.
Alex Jeffrey got up the next morning and went to work as though nothing had happened and had his Jeep detailed to get the evidence cleared out.
He explained the bloodstains in his car to the staff that he had hit a stray dog and then took the dog to the vet.
Detectives don't believe Alex's story and place him under arrest for Mercita's murder.
The fact that he would even compare her to a stray dog speaks of his callousness and of his mentality and his regard for Mercita Young.
But when the forensic techs finally unlock Mercita's cell phone, what they find appears to confirm at least some of Alex's story.
The text messages show that Mercita was getting pushier and pushier about turning their affair into an actual relationship.
Sounds like Ms. Young was becoming increasingly obsessed with him and just seemed unwilling to let the relationship continue as it had been.
Is it possible that he was trying to defend himself?
For detectives, the truth lies in the results of Mercita's autopsy.
The autopsy report paints a very different picture of the one that Dr. Jeffrey had tried to give to the police.
According to the autopsy findings, Alex hadn't just stabbed Mercita once or twice, as he claimed.
He stabbed this woman 22 times.
It's overkill, unnecessary. Why would someone stab her 20-something times? It was an act of rage.
It makes it very difficult to believe Dr. Jeffrey's story of self-defense.
Instead, another detail in the autopsy suggests Alex's real motive to murder Mercita.
At the time of her death, Mercita was pregnant.
DNA is able to prove that Dr. Jeffrey was the father of this unborn child.
The discovery puts the murder in a whole new light.
I do feel that he killed my sister because of her being pregnant with his child.
The detectives believe that either on the night she was killed or maybe shortly before, Mercita told Alex that she was pregnant.
She might have thought this was like her trump card, that, yeah, he's gonna accept me now. He's going to claim me in some way, shape, or form, whether he's just the dad or maybe he'll leave his wife. She might have went through all kinds of scenarios in her brain.
But there was one thing she didn't consider, how Alex would take the news.
When you tell a guy, honey, you're gonna be a father, it sort of puts a whole new look on that relationship. And it can be very jarring because all of a sudden, a man, particularly a married man, realizes, well, looks like I'm in the soup now because not only am I involved with this woman, but now she's pregnant.
Her having this child is gonna really just like blow his whole life up.
So he panicked. It almost seems that once she told him that she was pregnant, he then thought he had to get rid of the problem. There was no mention of an abortion. There was no mention of her being bought off. There was no mention of her just going away. Alex knew he had a problem, and his dealing with it was killing Mercita Young and his child.
The only way he could think of doing that was to lure her to a secluded area in Brooklyn.
Why are we stopping?
They don't stop for another hour.
So I guess we got some time to kill.
In the middle of having sex with her, which he admitted he was doing, he repeatedly stabbed her.
Only a monster would do that to somebody.
Caught by surprise, Mercita fought for her life.
She had defensive wounds on her hands because she was trying to block the slashes.
But she never had a chance.
This man was over 6 feet tall, 220 pounds.
Then, once Mercita was dead, Alex tried to cover up the crime.
He hid her body and took her cell phone, her wallet, and her ID, and got his car detailed and tried to get rid of all of the evidence.
Alex thought he was slick, but he wasn't slick enough. He was sloppy out of arrogance. Here was a man who had achieved a lot in life, who had enough arrogance to think that he could juggle two women at the same time and not get caught. So that kind of mentality carries over to the crime scene itself, where his consideration was, I can calculate how to kill Mercita Young, I can dispose of her body, and I can also get away with this crime, because who is going to suspect me? I am a respectable man. I'm a respectable family man. But it backfired on him. He got caught. He did not anticipate how good the police were.
With a solid case built against Alex, detectives formally charge him with the murder of Mercita Young.
He left her on the side of the road like a dead dog, and he then tells people that he hit a dead dog. It's almost like he was telling on himself.
However, Alex faces no charges for the death of Mercita's unborn child.
In other states, he would have been charged with a double homicide, but the statute is still not on the books in New York State.
An unborn child, when it's that early in the term, is not considered a person for the purpose of murder. He's not in New York State.
Adding insult to injury, Mercita's family is bombarded with the intimate details of the case being broadcast to the world.
This was very hard for Mercita's family because a lot of people were trying to blemish her character.
A single woman who's involved with a married man is cast in a bad light.
It was just everywhere. There was no way that I could mourn my sister's death.
In general, people definitely need a space to just be alone with their own thoughts, because what happens when you violate someone who's grieving is now your thoughts and feelings get interjected with theirs. They can't even keep their feelings separate, and they can't work through it because they don't know what came from them, what came from others. People's opinions have now gotten in the way, and they're really unable to kind of make peace with it. First of all, accept the fact that someone that you love is lost without even worrying about all the details around what happened. It doesn't even matter in the immediate aftermath. But you're unable to do that because there's so much noise.
But all the noise doesn't change what happened.
They can say she was wrong. That's all hindsight. The bottom line is she lost her life because she put value in a man that didn't put value in her.
Alex does value his life, though. Rather than risk a murder conviction, he pleads guilty to the lesser charge of manslaughter.
In July of 2018, nearly 5 years after Mercita was killed, Alex Jeffrey pleads guilty to first-degree manslaughter.
He was sentenced to 25 years, with 5 years already served, and I believe he's eligible for parole in 15 years.
Alex could be released by 2030. A disappointing blow for the people who loved Mercita most.
I think the judicial system has failed my niece and nephew and my sister. When I read my victim impact statement, I made it very clear to him that when the family is notified that he can possibly be paroled, that I will be at every parole hearing, making sure that they know that this man should not ever be allowed on the street.
I feel sad for her family. It feels like their pain wasn't taken seriously and the loss of this woman wasn't taken seriously.
And no one feels that loss more than Mercedes' children.
It was very traumatizing for them. After everything happened, they have different fathers. So my mom, who was next of kin, she had to go to family court and pretty much allow each father to take custody of their child. So my niece ended up staying in New York and now lives in the Bronx. And my nephew ended up going down to North Carolina, to Charlotte, to live with his father. They initially couldn't believe that their mom was gone and really struggled emotionally and socially because of it.
The death of Mercedes Young will affect her children for the rest of their lives.
But even as her family mourns the seeming miscarriage of justice, they keep Mercedes' memory alive.
I just want the world to remember that she was such a fun, loving person, that she was a great mother, a great friend, a great sister, that she wanted to help people be the best that they can be. She will always be a star in my heart because she's just everything to me. And I love her and I miss her so much.